them down and threaten us.
Is the singularity near?
The military-industrial complex.
The truth is out there.
The seven mountains of the influencers of culture.
To be as gods, you know,
catapult to propaganda.
From a mostly secure, undisclosed, split-level location on a cul-de-sac somewhere in the heartland of America, this is A View from the Bunker. Now, here's Derek Gilbert.
This is the kind of thing that we would like to think doesn't happen in our modern society, our modern world. But if estimates are correct, hundreds of thousands of prisoners of conscience in China have been literally harvested for their organs. Welcome to A View from the Bunker. I'm Derek Gilbert. Before we get into the topic tonight, or the meat of the conversation, we're going to show you the trailer for a documentary film that has won 11 awards. Has been shown a number of times on PBS here in the United States, but is still a topic that I think most of us would like to believe really doesn't happen. Watch this.
I was in Beijing when the crackdown occurred. Watched it happen. Pretended to be a tourist, a lost tourist, and watched old ladies get thrown into buses. I didn't know what I was seeing. I found it very disturbing.
This huge population, extremely vulnerable. Family didn't know where they were. Jailers didn't know who they were. And they became this just vast sea of expendable humanity.
The year was 2005. A patient of mine came to me one day and told me, "Doc, I have to tell you that I was scheduled to undergo heart transplantation on a specific date." And I looked at him and I said, "How can they schedule a heart transplant ahead of time 2 weeks?"
I was in the labor camp, a Tangfu labor camp in Beijing for 3 years. Every 3 months, we got a blood test.
An eye test, and a kidney test, everything.
No one in the mainstream press that have offices inside China are covering it inside China. And they're missing the story of what is one of the most catastrophic human rights violations in our time.
After I left China and my perspective totally changed, then I said, "Oh my God, I committed a crime."
The film is appropriately titled Hard to Believe. Our guest is a two-time Emmy winner for documentary work, the director of the film, Hard to Believe, Ken Stone. Ken, welcome to the program.
Thank you.
This is a topic that really makes your guts twist. How did you get involved with this particular project?
Actually, a longtime collaborator of mine, Irene Silber, said that she had been working with a cameraman on a project, and it was just a small video. I think it was about veterinarian, something like that. And they were just talking during some downtime, and photographer Matthias Magnusson, who actually ended up working on the documentary, had mentioned to Irene that this was going on, and he always wanted to tell a story about it, and he was so frustrated that, in particular, American media just tended not to pay attention to it. So she thought it was really interesting, and Irene and I had collaborated before in a couple of other documentaries that we had been able to get on public television stations around the country. And so she called me up and said, "What do you think?" And so the story, I wish I could say, is like, well, that's hard to believe. I mean, I didn't say that right away.
Yeah.
But I thought, well, I don't know. Let me look into it. So I started to look into it. And one of my first sources was the David Matus book that he wrote. And then I read, found out about Ethan Gutman and got a hold of Ethan Gutman, a journalist, longtime American journalist, who has been writing about this topic and other China topics for 20 years. And then after I read those two books, I thought, yeah, there's a story here. And to me, what was interesting, and this is sort of selfish, but it's like, wow, this story really hasn't been told that much before. And I'm an old news guy, and you know, you get a chance to tell a story that really hasn't been told much. That's an opportunity you tend to jump at.
Mm-hmm. You've got a background that didn't start in film. You've got a kind of a diverse background in media, news, talk radio and so forth. What led you into your filmmaking? Was it to tell stories like this, or and how far afield is this particular story from the type of thing that led you to filmmaking in the first place?
Two different questions there.
I have a tendency to ask that to do that.
The first one is I had worked in radio and TV newsrooms for 20 years, mostly as a reporter, but also as an anchor, host, talk show, news director. I mean, all that stuff. Basically, I couldn't hold a job like anybody else in TV news.
I've been there.
So when I got laid off from my last television news station, I thought, well, what's next? And I ended up starting to teach, and I taught at the University of Minnesota for 7 years. But I had a boss there who said, we love your work, but we're not going to pay you very much because you're an instructor. You're not a tenured professor, so you should keep busy on the side. So I just started to do work on the side, mostly for nonprofits. And most of the stuff is that I've worked on, was 2 to 5 minutes long. But during that time, I stumbled into a couple of projects that were half-hour documentaries and that kind of thing. So I didn't. There was no intention to become a documentary film producer or director. It's just one of those things about, oh, that looks interesting. And I ended up doing the story. I did a story about post-traumatic stress with returning warriors from Vietnam, not Vietnam. Well, actually, it included Vietnam, but it was primarily Afghanistan and Iraq. And the challenge that mental health professionals were going to have, because there are literally not enough mental health professionals to handle the tidal wave that's coming back. Mm-hmm. So I got interested in that. I did a documentary on that. And so that is... sorry, I got a phone call here.
That's all right.
I'm declining. So I stumbled into it. And just as I stumbled into the story about organ harvesting, so it was far afield. I'm not an international reporter. I don't know a whole lot about China. I'm certainly not a medical expert either. And I knew very little about the Falun Gong. And so all of this was new. And so I went into it with what I thought was a relatively fresh set of eyes, because it's like, well, I don't know anything about it. Mm.
When you contacted Ethan Gutman, who's been looking at this topic for quite some time, how easy was it to convince him that you could tell this story coming in as somebody who was not familiar with it or the country that much?
We had a Skype conversation that lasted about an hour and a half one day, and I remember thinking he was the key. This was early on, we hadn't shot a thing, and it's such a complicated story, and it's got so many different facets to it. And so one of the things that I was interested in from a storytelling perspective is that we need to find some protagonists. And to me, Ethan would be one of the protagonists. Basically, the John the Baptist wandering through the media wilderness saying, hey, that's what's going on. So it didn't take a lot to convince him, but he was skeptical at first because he said, this is too complicated of a story to do in an hour. And I laughed and I said, I could do it in 2 minutes if I had to, back in my old TV news days.
Yeah.
but I understood what he was saying. But we persuaded him that it's like, listen, we're taking this approach. And basically the approach was we break things into chapters and we find protagonists, heroes, people to follow for those 5, 6, 7, 8 minutes. And we thread them together. And so Ethan, to me, was the important one in that he would be the most accessible to a public television audience. Mm. Public TV viewers, American viewers, know who he is. They don't know who Ethan is personally. But, oh, yeah, he's the cranky reporter who sort of works on the outside. He's a bit of a character. So they could identify with him. Mm-hmm. So it's like, this is such a strange and different and foreign topic, literally, that we needed someone like him that audience could go, oh, okay, I'll listen to him for a while. And then we start meeting people that Ethan had met along the way. The doctor from Western China, Dr. Enver Toti, and people just don't want to leave me alone. Sorry.
That's all right.
So So Ethan had met Enver Toti. He was a surgeon who actually did perform a live organ harvest transplant. And of course, Ethan had met David Matus. He's the Canadian human rights lawyer. Ethan had also met Dr. Jacob Levy, who is this Israeli heart surgeon. So it was sort of like, so we were sort of following, in a sense, Ethan's book, trying to piece together the different parts of the story. Who are all these people involved in this? So that's it's a long way to answer the question. It didn't take Ethan too long to convince him that, yeah, we should do this. It took a little while for him to really be convinced that the way we were going to do it was going to work. But he was willing to work with us, and so we appreciated his leap of faith.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, as a I imagine as a print reporter, he was looking at the depth of detail that he would normally go into when telling a story versus how you need to condense the story and how you substitute. And maybe I should ask this as a question. How do you go about then substituting images to show what somebody like Ethan Guttman would have written into a whole chapter and then managed to fit that, you know, the length of a book into a 56-minute story?
Right. And of course, Ethan is, you know, the expression is old China hand. So he, you know, tosses around leaders' names and dissidents' names from 20, 30 years ago. Like, I'm supposed to know who these people are and supposed to know all their backstories. And I'm supposed to know, you know, I'm supposed to know, because he knows, he's such an expert in the field. You're right. He's an expert as much as one can be on the labor system in China, the labor camp system. And, you know, there's no way that we can, there's no real way we can match that. And we didn't try to. Mm-hmm. One of the things that I thought was important in the documentary is that we were not going to pretend to try to convince people, here's the smoking gun, we're going to prove that this really does happen. To me, that was not the story. And it's sort of like a fool's errand. Basically, we were just saying, there is some really convincing, strong evidence that this is going on. And so even if we're not sure it is or not, how come no one's talking about it? To me, that was the interesting part of the story. It's not that, can you prove it or not? It's just like, why aren't we talking about it?
Yeah, it seems shocking enough that this ought to be front page news. What were some of the reasons that came out during the course of the conversations with Ethan that his investigation turned up that might explain why this is such a big secret?
It's there are so many reasons, and probably one of the better ways to explain it is that there is a Congressional Executive Committee on China. It is a big thing in Washington. Very smart people involved. Every year they come out with a detailed, you know, 500-page report on China, and it has to do with human rights in China and the economy in China and all the things that the United States government should be worried about and think about when engaging with China. And organ harvesting is mentioned briefly twice. And it's not because the people in Washington don't know that it's going on. It's that there's just such a long list of other things that people in Washington are really concerned about, that the plight of these political prisoners and what may be happening to them or not is just less important than all the other human rights and other issues that they have. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm not saying that that's the right judgment or not, but that's one of the reasons. I mean, the people in Washington who are paying attention to it are basically saying, yeah, we know there's that problem, and here's a stack of other problems. So that's one thing. Part of it is that the Falun Gong, which is the spiritual practice that, and it seems to be that most of these people, the majority of the people who had been rounded up were Falun Gong practitioners, Falun Dafa practitioners, and it's a Buddhist spiritual practice. It's not an organized religion by any stretch, but it's just really a practice that, because Americans don't know much about that spiritual practice, there's no empathy with those people. It's like, oh, it seems to be some sort of strange thing that people are doing.
Easy to apply the cult label to
it. And they're
it.
Asian people, and they're doing some sort of strange little Buddhist thing over there. And it's like, okay. And so there's no historical connection, and there's no emotional connection. So part of it is that the American public doesn't care because they just don't get it. They don't understand what the Falun Gong is, what Falun Dafa is. So the American public is engaged about, for instance, the people in Tibet, because they, through the Cold War many years ago, American public understood who the Tibetans were, understood what the problem was. And so the American public is concerned about the Tibetans, but not so much about people who are, you know, engaging in the spiritual practice. Doesn't make logical sense, perhaps, but that's just the way that the history
human nature.
Goes.
Yeah.
And part of it is the media has not paid attention, and the media has not paid attention by and large is because the American public has not paid attention, and the American politicians haven't paid attention. So if they're not paying attention, the media is not going to pay attention. And frankly, religious leaders in this country really haven't paid that much attention. And so again, because each of these sectors are not paying attention, the media is not paying attention. So it's a chicken egg thing.
Mm-hmm. And of course you get the economic interdependence of the United States and China, and we don't want to rock the boat because they hold so much of our debt. They supply so many of our cheap shoes and electronics. I wonder, as a newsman who's been through some radical changes in the way television and radio news has operated over the last 30 or 40 years, the internet has really changed things a lot. I got out of the business in the early 90s, came back in 2006 briefly, just long enough to see what had changed and remember why I got out the first time. How much of the de-emphasis in news gathering is playing a role in this story not being told?
You mean because the news media is afraid to do stories on China?
Well,
because China is such a big economic giant.
That may be part of it, but I think more, I need to do a better job of focusing my questions. In recent years, we've seen newspapers struggling. People aren't reading newspapers as much as, but newsrooms have been cut. I saw personally on the local level, local radio news has been de-emphasized to the point where you've got one news person doing the job where they used to have a six-person news staff.
Right. Well, until TMZ gets interested in the story, I'm not sure that it's ever. But that's part of it. It's like the American public, by and large, tends not to be interested in international news. This story gets way more play overseas. There's a lot more interest in this story in Germany and in England and in Canada because there is just an ethic that the populations in those countries pay attention to what's happening in the rest of the world. In the U.S., as you know, we pay attention sometimes, but by and large, we don't pay attention unless we think something directly affecting us.
Right, right.
And then we pay attention. Mm-hmm. So if it's obviously Afghanistan, Saddam Hussein in Iraq and that kind of thing, Lord knows, then the media, American media, pays a ton of attention because the American public is paying attention to that.
Yeah.
But by and large, we don't pay attention to international events.
Right. So how difficult was it then to build a sense of connection between these political prisoners, the Falun Gong, and the viewer when you made the film?
Well, and so from a storyteller's perspective, that was one of the challenges. It's like we told the story first of Ethan, and then we tell the story of Enver Toti, who is this Uyghur surgeon, Western Chinese surgeon, who in the early 1990s did a organ transplant, and it seems to me he's in a sense Dr. Zero, that this was an early experiment, if you are to believe Enver Toti's story, which I think it's hard not to believe that story. So we go from Enver, and then David Matus, who is a human rights lawyer in Canada, also sort of walks right out of central casting. He's like every human rights lawyer you've ever seen. You know, he's small, he's shrunken, he won't stop. So we tell these people's stories, and then we got to Jacob Levy, who's this Israeli surgeon who had a heart patient walk into his office one day and say, "Doc, I got to tell you, I've been on the waiting list too long. My insurance company is sending me to China. I'm going to get a heart 2 weeks from Tuesday." And Dr. Levy was like, do you listen to yourself? He says, you know, how can they guarantee you a heart 2 weeks from today? And, you know, the patient said, I don't know, I didn't ask. But at that point, then Levy starts investigating. Levy then stumbles upon Matus's research. And then we tell the story of Dr. Levy and what he did in Israel to change it so that Israeli citizens would not go to China. And he was successful in that. And what made it interesting, and then Ethan sort of ties it back and says, look at what Levy's been able to do in Israel, but countries elsewhere haven't done what they've done. And what Israel basically did, the Knesset, they refused to pay for any illegally procured organ. Mm-hmm. And so it just shut off Israeli citizens from going to China. Now, Israeli citizens could go to China if they want to, pay on their own dime.
Right.
But as Levy said, it seems that none of them has. And it has to do with the history of their country. They just, you know, there's too much shame to do that.
Yeah.
And that's what drove Levy. So that was an interesting story. Levy, son of a Holocaust survivor. And, you know, he looked at it as if, well, you know, no one stood outside the gates when my father was thrown into the labor camp. How can I not do something about what's happening to what I think these people in China? So you tell Levy's story. So it was through, you know, so you keep on telling these different personal stories. It doesn't tell the complete story of what's going on, which is so complex, but it's like, wow, there's a doctor story about a doctor who did something. Oh, there's a human rights lawyer story who's trying to do something. Oh, there's the cranky journalist. Here's this really interesting, thoughtful doctor who's now in exile in England with one small personal story. So, you know, little pieces of the jigsaw puzzle. And so we, 3/4 of the way through the piece, we finally meet a woman who is a Falun Gong practitioner, and her father, one of the earliest people to have been arrested in the crackdown on Falun Gong practitioners back in 1999. And so we told her story. Now, her story wasn't a story about organ harvesting, but it was a story about Falun Gong practitioners and what's happened to them. And, you know, she's been trying to get her father out of China for a long, long time. And then we finally went to the medical community. There was a big conference in San Francisco, Transplantation Society. And so then we went there to talk about that story. And so we just wove different people into, this is when we were in California, we got a hold of a congressman, Dana Rohrabach.
Yeah.
Rohrabacher, right. And a very conservative Republican, through him we were able to tell the political story. He talks about it all the time, but because he's considered too far to the right, he's not paid attention to. And frankly, people way on the left are also not paid attention to. So it's this interesting dynamic that the mainstream does not want to engage with what these people want to engage with.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. This is a story that probably hits closer to home than a lot of Americans realize. I personally know two members of my extended family who have lost their lives because they couldn't get transplants quickly enough. One a heart, another kidneys. And I know in one case, there were some thoughts of perhaps traveling to India for considering that is an option. It obviously eventually decided against it. But it seems to me that this is a problem that wouldn't exist if there wasn't a demand for these organs. In the research that Gutman and pulled together, did he get any sense of how many of the recipients of these organs were Chinese versus Westerners?
No, that's of all the research that they've done, and the research they've done is pretty impressive. That is the slipperiest number. Again, it's, you know, what are the telltale signs? And it's websites of these transplant hospitals, which are in English, and a lot of anecdotal stories. Are there numbers as to how many Americans or how many Westerners have gone to China to get transplants? You're left with estimates, and frankly, the Chinese government, you know, keeps on saying, hey, you know, this is all smoke and mirrors. You have no hard evidence. You have no hard numbers. And when it comes to that part of the story, you're right. They don't have any hard numbers.
Hmm. most of my broadcasting career was in music radio. Started out in radio news, but then learned that nobody needs a 19-year-old talk show host because you don't know anything. Got into the talk radio
too much, one or the other.
But got back into it in the second part of my career. But I saw enough of the news side to know that there are times when you have to bring to the public stories that are really distasteful and really unpleasant. As far as your career goes, how does this story rate compared to other things you've had to cover?
It was a difficult story in that it was so big, and there was a lot of fog, you know. So that was difficult. And the subject itself is horrific. Make no mistake. I mean, it's, you know, some people talk about it being a Holocaust, but I'm not close enough to that Holocaust. I'm not close enough to the people who have lost their lives, family members who are grieving. They're all behind that curtain, right? Yeah. There was a bit of horror, but it was, you know, frankly, at a distance. I guess we shot most of this documentary in the U.S. We went to England for 4 days to do shooting there with Enver Toti, who's the doctor. But by and large, we did everything from within the U.S. And part of that was because this is what we're able to do. To have done the story that I wish, you know, we could have done would have been $2 million in 2 years, and much more international travel. Mm-hmm. And it was just a story that I, you know, frankly, we didn't have the money to do and couldn't do. So it's like, so how can we get this story out with the time that we have and the amount of money that we had? And so this seemed the best way to do it. And because of that, I am absolutely a little bit removed from that horror, because I'm talking to a very nice Israeli doctor. I'm talking to a very sympathetic woman who wants her father back, but, you know, that's a little bit of a distance. Talking to an interesting attorney, interesting doctors, interesting journalists, talking to interesting politicians, but they're all domestic, and they're all, each one of them is a step removed from what could be the horror.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore it wasn't difficult from an emotional point of view because I wasn't that close to it.
Mm. What was the, the most difficult aspect of the story, the most difficult thing that, came to light as you talked with, the various people involved, in terms of the scope of the story or
no,
the fact that,
one small moment, and it was Enver Toti, who is the doctor. He's the Uyghur doctor. He was a surgeon. He was ordered to go to the execution grounds, and he didn't know why. He was told, wait here. When you hear the gunshots, come around. And then it's like, this is the guy you're going to operate on. And so it's only when the guy is on the table, and this is literally outside, you know, that he realizes the guy's alive still, because he had not been shot in the heart. But he had been shot not in the heart. And basically he was being ordered to cut, you know. So that was a horrible story. And he told it to us in this very small flat that he has in London. And this was the moment that got me. And he goes, and at the end of the day, my chief surgeon said, Enver, remember, nothing happened today. And that line just sort of stuck with me because obviously it stuck with Enver. Nothing happened today. It was such a small detail that I think speaks to the horror of what we think is going on over there.
Hmm. This film has obviously gathered some attention. 11 Film Awards. It's been broadcast more than 40 times on PBS here in the U.S. What sort of response reaction have you gotten? Have you gotten any pushback from people who wished you hadn't told the story?
No, I haven't. One of the things when I first got into this story is that some of the people I was talking to, and these are Falun Gong practitioners by and large, and not necessarily Chinese. The, you know, Falun Gong practitioners are American, Australian, English, the whole lot. they all talked about, well, I've had my email hacked. I've had my tires slashed occasionally. That kind of thing. So they said, so be prepared for some pushback or some difficulty. It hasn't happened to me. Not yet. Knock wood. I believe these people in saying that they have been harassed in some manner, shape, or form.
Hmm. What impact has this story made on you personally?
For one thing, I was a little bit embarrassed that I didn't know about the story. I'm a news guy, and I've lived overseas, and I pay attention to international news. And, it's only when Irene called me up and told me, say, check this out. So I was a little sheepish and embarrassed that I didn't know anything about the story. I was left with the feeling that, well, I should have known. And not should have known what exactly is the truth. Again, we don't know what the truth is, but I should have known that something's going on that's, hard to believe. And it took me so long to find out.
Yeah. And again, that's why the film is aptly named, because when you hear about this and hear about the potential scope of the problem, it is hard to believe.
Yeah. And we got the title actually from one of the interviews. It was a human rights person in Washington, D.C., who was, and I was asking her, well, why isn't this getting the attention of the human rights communities so much? And she was giving me the answers, and she said, well, in the allegations, she says, they're sort of hard to believe. And she wasn't saying that she didn't believe in them, but she was just saying, well, that's just, and so that's where the title came from. She was right. That's part of the reason why we haven't heard about it, because it's just a little bit too hard to believe. So we don't.
Yeah. Ken Stone is the director of the film Hard to Believe. There'll be links in the show notes as to where you can find it and watch it. It's available for streaming at a number of online locations: Vimeo, iTunes, Amazon Instant Video, Google Play, and so forth. Ken Stone Media Services, put a link to your website as well, sir. And
thank you.
Again, appreciate your time, and thank you for putting this story together and bringing this to the attention of the public, and hopefully we can help direct it.
I just wanted to say thank you for paying attention.
Well, It seems, again, as somebody who has a tendency to believe he's the smartest person in the room, which I should be old enough to know better by now, but, when I stumbled across Ethan Gutman's story and saw the interviews with him, I had the same reaction. How come I didn't know about this? So, Ken, thank you very much.
All right. Thank you.
There is a link to the film Hard to Believe in the show notes, which you'll find two places, vftb.net. And the video channel, which is now at YouTube, youtube.com/Derek Gilbert. You can subscribe there, get an email update every time I post a new View from the Bunker episode. Again, Hard to Believe, the film, worth watching, because this is a subject that we should be talking about. This is unconscionable, both the practice itself and the fact that those in a position to know in the governments of the United States and the Western world are saying nothing about this. This week, shifting topics, was the 50th anniversary of the first broadcast of Star Trek, the original television series. That was September 8th, 1966, when they began the five-year voyage to explore the unknown. It is interesting how a show that just lasted three seasons on network television has become one of those cultural landmarks. The recent reboot of the television or the film series, the film franchise, helmed by J.J. Abrams, starring Chris Pine as Captain Kirk, Zachary Quinto as Mr. Spock. Wonderful cast. I was really leery when they announced they were going to reboot the films, but I have to admit they've done an excellent job of it. It is not just a wonderful form of entertainment, but as Sharon and I discussed on Sci Friday this week, which you'll find at youtube.com/Sci Friday, the series has motivated a lot of science fiction fans, geeks, to pursue careers in science. And many of the things discussed on Star Trek, introduced back in 1966, are now part of our everyday lives, like the laptop computer, the handheld devices. In fact, our cell phones are probably more powerful than the communicators that were used on Star Trek. Of course, we don't have the range. You can't talk to ships in space, as far as I know. But in just about every other way, they're even more powerful than those little communicators. But when you dig a little bit and look at this from a biblical perspective, as Sharon and I did, you know, understanding that we appreciate the series and love the series for entertainment. I liked The Next Generation just as well. In fact, I had the opportunity in my broadcasting career to interview a couple of the actors who starred in Star Trek The Next Generation and Deep Space Nine. Rene Aubergenois, who starred as Odo in Deep Space Nine, and got to interview LeVar Burton, who was Geordi LaForge on The Next Generation. Again, as a science fiction lover, great entertainment. But Gene Roddenberry's vision was one of a scientific utopia, which is a vision that technocrats and transhumanists are trying to enact today. And we touched on that in this week's Sci Friday, Sharon and I, discussing how the vision of Gene Roddenberry was or is getting close to fulfillment. Now, there are those who can argue whether the transhumanists will ever really achieve their dream of being able to create an artificial replica of the human mind. I would argue that you can't, but we'll talk about that a little bit more in just a second. But even if they do, the fact that they don't have a problem, or they don't have a solution for the problem of sin, the human heart, means that rather than creating heaven on earth, they're actually going to create the opposite. There was an episode, and we didn't mention this during the program. There just wasn't time in that 28 minutes, actually 24 minutes by the time you get down to, you know, intro, outro, and a plug for books, to discuss a couple of episodes, well, actually a number of them, both in the original series and in The Next Generation, where you deal with beings of godlike power who are still unregenerate in their attitudes, their prejudices, their biases, their hatreds, their pettiness. And you find that when you couple godlike abilities with human flaws, you wind up with the recipe for a nightmare. You know, the original series had an episode where they encountered some of the old Greek gods. Then there was the episode where they encountered the being called Tremaine. Was it Trelane? Well, I forget. But anyway, it turns out he was just a naughty child, but because he was so powerful, he put the lives of the entire crew of the Enterprise at risk. On The Next Generation, there were the encounters they had with the being Q, who was a being of godlike power, but certainly was not the kind of God that you or I would like to serve, certainly nothing like Yahweh. And when you look at the cosmologies, as I've been doing over the last few months, of the ancient world, the Sumerians, the Akkadians, the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Greeks, the Romans, Africans with their animist belief, which extends down to present day, the religions that came into the New World, sort of a syncretistic mix of Roman Catholicism and pagan occultism, you know, through Haiti, things like voodoo and other belief systems. You're dealing with beings of supernatural power, but exhibiting the same type of dangerously hateful behavior that we humans show toward one another. And if you create an entire world of beings who are immortal and have nearly godlike abilities through enhanced biology, or perhaps some mix of biology and technology, without addressing the problem of sin, you're basically creating hell on earth. And that is the upshot of the transhumanist movement. Now, interestingly, and we didn't have time to get into this either, but Gene Roddenberry, as Peter Lavenda points out in his book, his series, and I always forget the name of the three-book set. well, anyway, I'll look it up here while I'm talking. Peter Lavenda's three-book set on, what he calls it, a grimoire of American political witchcraft. he deals with a group called the Nine, a group of entities contacted by occultists led by a researcher for the CIA. Paskarich was the gentleman's last name. Yep, almost found it, not quite. Sinister Forces, that's the name of the Sinister Forces, the name of the three-book set, which we highly recommend. There were a group of entities that made contact with a group of people drawn from the elite classes of American society, high society, in the 50s and 60s. They made contact with this group that called themselves the Nine. And as the series of communications continued with the Nine, and this group of people who were holding these seances kind of shifted in and out, Gene Roddenberry was actually one of the people who became a part of this group that would make contact with the Nine. And over time, they determined that the Nine, as they identified themselves, were not extraterrestrials, but they were actually the Ennead, E-N-N-E-A-D, the Nine chief gods of the Egyptian pantheon. And they were planning to return to Earth. It's not a coincidence that Deep Space Nine was Deep Space Nine and not Deep Space Three. So Roddenberry, even though he envisioned and portrayed through the series a scientistic utopia, a society, human society, that had transcended our superstitions based on the old gods, he was very much a believer in the return of the old gods. And they dealt with issues of theology on a pretty regular basis. Now, Deep Space Nine is a show that I didn't pay as much attention to as I should have, because I know that the protagonist, the lead character there, Benjamin Sisko, Commander Sisko, who captained Deep Space Nine, was the fulfillment of some prophecy of one of the people groups on the program. So there's probably more there than I'm sure there's more there than I'm aware of. But again, It just speaks to a larger point, and this is what we touched on Sci-Friday, that as much as the technologists and the transhumanists would like to believe, and they may genuinely believe, some of them, that they are leading us toward humanity's destiny, which is a technological utopia, they are, in fact, facilitating a move back to the old gods. As I talked about with Carl Teichrib earlier this week, and you'll hear a longer version of the interview coming up on A View from the Bunker in late September, festivals like Burning Man are a symptom of the trend in human society of a longing to return to paganism and the old gods. And again, those old gods were every bit as flawed and limited in their capacities for love, forgiveness, and righteousness as we humans are. It's just that they weren't limited by our biology. And if the transhumanists are successful in their drive to overcome the limits of our biology, they will have, in fact, turned us into the old gods. And as I said, it's a recipe for hell on earth, not heaven. Coming up on A View from the Bunker, there's a story that came out just very quickly that makes this point. Researchers at Princeton found, when they programmed a machine learning algorithm, which is how computer scientists have to program artificial intelligences. They have to essentially just stuff data into a neural network and then hope for the desired output on the other side. They really don't know what happens inside the black boxes. It's like the human mind. They really don't know what's going on in here. But they found that when they ran about a trillion words of English text from the internet through a machine learning algorithm in the hopes of teaching it English and to infer associations between the words, they found that not only did the machine learning algorithm, the artificial intelligence, interpret the meanings of the words correctly, they also absorbed the biases that we associate with those words, both gender and race and creed. For example, words like salary and management were associated by this algorithm with men, males. Words like home and family were typically associated with women, females. And I think this is hysterical because as the technocrats, technologists, transhumanists try to overcome our human flaws, we're finding that as we try to program machines to improve upon human nature, our biology, they're programming our flaws into the artificial intelligences that we create. Again, all we're doing is creating beings with the same flaws, but far more power, and that will ultimately be a recipe for hell on earth. Coming up on A View from the Bunker, two more interviews from the Rocky Mountain International Prophecy Conference, people I know very well. One I work with, one I live with. That would be Josh Peck, co-worker here at Skywatch TV and host of Into the Multiverse, and my best friend, my wife, Sharon Gilbert, co-host of Sci Friday, co-host of many of our programs on Skywatch TV, and host of the forthcoming Skywatch Women on Skywatch TV. She's also the author of a new series of novels forthcoming called The Red Wing Saga. I won't tell you any more than that, but just keep watch for it because I've read the first novel, and it is really, really good. Even as a guy who likes lots of gunplay and explosions, it's good stuff. That will be released on Wednesday, September 14th. September 18th, a guest we've not had on the program for over 10 years, Janet Phelan, discussing why the elites want you dead. She was a guest on PID Radio back in 2006. She went on the run, fearing for her safety. She is one who has got firsthand experience of the guardianship scandal taking place here in the United States. That's how we reconnected. That interview, Sunday, September 18th. September 21st, two more interviews from the Rocky Mountain International Prophecy Conference. And by the way, I should be promoting this. I don't do as good a job of talking myself up, I suppose, as I could. These Rocky Mountain International Prophecy Conference interviews are exclusive to Skywatch, to A View from the Bunker. Now, you'll get to see the video when the DVD set from the conference is released, and that's coming out in October, maybe November. But Prophecy Watchers very graciously allowing me to use the audio here for, well, for people who weren't able to attend the conference or afford the video streaming packages. And I hope that you'll finding these of use. The exclusive Rocky Mountain International Prophecy Conference interview series continues on A View from the Bunker on September 21st. Jeff Kinley and Joseph Farah, the publisher of WorldNet Daily, WND.com, they'll be the guests on the interviews revealed on September 21st. The Gilbert House Fellowship, our Bible study, continues on Sunday. We're going through the Bible, Old Testament and New Testament, in chronological order. And we post those studies on by about midday every Sunday at gilberthouse.org. And Monday, tomorrow, another episode in the audiobook edition of my novel, The God Conspiracy, first published about 10 years ago, but available now as an audiobook released in episodes every Monday, new episode every Monday, released through the YouTube channel. So make sure you subscribe to get a notice every time I put out a new episode. That's at youtube.com/Derek Gilbert, or you can go directly to it by logging onto The God Conspiracy, all one word, thegodconspiracy.tk. I should mention, by the way, A View from the Bunker website, the VFTB.net website, is on hold, as is my personal website, DerekPGilbert.com, as we're in the process of moving hosting companies. And it is a long process because we have a lot of audio from PID Radio, VFTB.net. So in the process of moving these websites, because we're getting no help at all from our former hosting company, or soon to be former, Bluehost.com, this is taking longer than I had hoped because I'm trying to do it around a work schedule. So I'm not taking up company time to move our personal websites, but we got to move my site, Sharon's site, the View from the Bunker site, the PID Radio site, PID News site, Gilbert House Fellowship site, Gilbert House Productions site, the site for the forthcoming book, Rise of the Cyber Gods. We've got a site for my sister-in-law, site for our daughter. There are like a dozen websites that we got to move and a couple of gigabytes worth of audio and stuff that's got to be transferred over. It's a lot of material. The new hosting company's been great. They've been offering a lot of help, a lot of suggestions, but we really need some cooperation from Bluehost, and they ain't giving it. So in order to keep things from being more complicated, everything on the websites is kind of on hold. So this you know, the View from the Bunker interviews, I'll keep putting them out there, but for another week or so, you may only see the updates on the YouTube channel. So if you want to be updated, please subscribe at youtube.com/Derek Gilbert. Appreciate your reviews of A View from the Bunker at iTunes, the iTunes Store, or Stitcher, wherever you hear us. And make sure you log on and give us a like at Facebook, where we discuss the issues raised on the programs here. That's facebook.com/viewfromthebunker. A View from the Bunker is a production of Gilbert House and released under Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial No Derivatives 4.0 International License. The opening theme is by Kevin MacLeod. His website is incompetech.com. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. I'm Derek Gilbert, and this is A View from the Bunker.